To all clinicians and medical students out there, if you are having a hard time making sense of antibiotics, don't worry, you are not alone. And it's not a matter of intelligence, work ethic, or willingness to learn. Anyone who survives medical school has no problem in those departments, that's for sure. The actual problem lies in the very way we were taught about antibiotics in the first place. You are supposed to memorize the spectrum of a million different drugs, their pharmacokinetic properties, their chemistry and whatnot, and the idea is that once you've somehow crammed all of this into your head, you will miraculously turn into a master clinician, right? Provided, of course, that you don't forget 95% of what you learned the minute after you regurgitated on some multiple choice exam. You would think that out of all people, at least doctors would be aware that the human brain doesn't work like that. Once you are done with years of forced memorization, you are thrown into the real world and all of a sudden you have to make real world decisions and use antibiotics to treat real patients. By now, of course, you have forgotten everything that you think you knew, and worse yet, you realize that so many things you should have learned were not in the books. At least that's how it was for me. So, what do you do now? Well, you learn as you go because you don't have time for anything else anymore. When it comes to antibiotics, you learn that this one is for pharyngitis, this one is for pneumonia, and for sepsis, it's best you go with that one. I call this the Harry Potter approach because antibiotics make about as much sense as random magic spells in the Harry Potter book. To be fair, the Harry Potter approach does work, but only to a point. And it won't be long before you run into a wall, or worse yet, make a serious mistake without even knowing. Because at the end of the day, with the Harry Potter approach, you don't really know what it is that you are doing. Look at this old study from 2009. It showed that inappropriate antibiotics in the treatment of septic shock reduced the chances of survival 5 times. Not 50%, 5 times. So, if you miss, your patient is 5 times more likely to die. Okay, septic shock is a little bit extreme, but if we look at sepsis without shock, which is quite common by the way, again, we find the same thing. Countless studies that show a significant percentage of patients with sepsis also receive inappropriate antibiotics. Antibiotics that do not cover the cause of their illness. This happens all the time. So, how many are we talking about here? Well, even the study with the lowest percentage of such misses is terrifying. 14%. That's about 1 in 7. And some studies put that number as high as 75%. But it's not like we are much better with milder infections like pharyngitis either. Here, the mistakes are even more common, but fortunately, at least the consequences are less brutal. But we can still feel them. We are all affected by the global consequences of inadequate use of antibiotics. First and foremost, insane rates of bacterial resistance all over the world. In North America, for example, MRSA has become a domestic animal, and in Southern Europe, carbapenem-resistant bacteria have flooded the hospitals and they are spilling over into the community, making the treatment of community-acquired infections harder than ever. So much about your Harry Potter approach being reliable, right? This disaster with antibiotics mostly stems from a lack of knowledge on part of everyone involved. And I'm not saying this to blame clinicians, quite the contrary. Again, I emphasize, it's the way we were taught about antibiotics that is woefully inadequate. And clinicians are well aware of that. They want to learn, but they don't know where to start. I mean, what are they supposed to do? Go back to their textbooks from medical school? And you know what? I bet many even would, if they knew it would get them the result they want. But considering how well that worked for them the first time around, why would it be any better now? And don't get me wrong, it's not the textbooks that are the problem. I love my textbooks. But if you want to get up to speed quickly, and you are not a specialist in that field, they are too big, too detailed, and if you don't know exactly what you are looking for, and you usually don't when you're just starting out, it's easy to get lost in them and the whole thing will end up being counterproductive. So you got to ask yourself, is there a better way? Is there a way to become proficient with antibiotics without sacrificing months of your life or actually specializing in infectious diseases? And the answer is, yes, there is. Of course there is. As someone who does specialize in infectious diseases, I did spend a very long time studying antibiotics, gathering experience, reading, checking, second-guessing everything. And yes, after a few years, I came to understand antibiotics very well, to the point where I'm now certain that I will not forget what I know. Did I have to spend that much time to get to this goal? Yes, because when you are learning on your own and starting from scratch, that is what you do. And it's a very long, frustrating process riddled with mistakes. It's so easy to get lost and miss crucial points, which means you have to go back and again and again. Because it's incredibly difficult to find all the information you need and connect all the dots in the right moment so that it all makes sense right from the start. But if I could travel back in time with all the knowledge and experience I have now and mentor my younger self, there is no question that I would get him to the same goal in only a fraction of the time. I'm saying this because I'm well aware that other doctors like internists, family physicians, or emergency physicians don't have months to study antibiotics, not even close, because there is an endless list of other things that they need to master, and antibiotics are not the center of their universe. Still, they know full well how vital antibiotics are, and they are eager to learn. The good news is that with a little bit of guidance and the right approach, this is very doable. So, instead of wandering and torturing yourself for months, you can do wonders in just a few days. And that would be a time well spent. Of course, you will not become an infectious diseases specialist overnight, but that is not the goal. If you simply want to understand antibiotics very well, and you want to learn how to use them to treat patients with the most common and most dangerous infections with confidence, and you want to learn how to deal with complications and real-world dilemmas that are bound to happen in practice, you absolutely can and should do this. And it's not rocket science. If you survive medical school, you will crush this without breaking a sweat. And you will replace the constant feeling of insecurity about antibiotics with competence and well-founded confidence. You just need a clear path to make sure that every minute you spend on this counts and that it turns into long-lasting practical knowledge. In the next video, I'm going to show you the approach I came up with after years of learning and teaching antibiotics. It will be simple, but not oversimplified to the point where it will become useless or wrong. Once you get used to this way of thinking, it will feel like common sense, and I'm sure that you will appreciate the immense flexibility it gives you. You will learn how to adapt to any clinical scenario and come up with a solid solution that you can back up with clear clinical reasoning. And I'm confident you will realize that no doctor can afford not to know this, because all it takes is a few days and the difference will be night and day. I'm really looking forward to showing you how it all works. If you haven't had the chance to do so, let me know what it is about antibiotics that you find most difficult to grasp, something you really struggle with, and I will do my best to answer it in the upcoming videos. Take care.